you so much for joining us today for this discussion that we have set up on the Union Budget 2023. Format we propose to follow today is basically to examine some of the key aspects from a direct and indirect taxes, which will be followed by introduction of our eminent panelists for today, and then we will get into the discussions with each of them. So I think the first thing thing I would like to highlight as far as budget 2023 goes, it's not come out with any big bang changes as far as direct tax goes, at least. So, we have mostly status quo with some minor changes being undertaken. Of course, there was a lot of expectation that the capital gains tax regime would be overhauled, which has not happened. And certain changes with respect to the BEPS Pillar 2 also, which was expected, has not fructified really. I think one of the most important changes, probably let's start with the amendment to Section 5627B, which basically is also known as the angel tax very popularly. This provision has been amended today, change being that it is going to extend also to non-resident shareholders who propose to invest into an Indian company. So just to give a background, Section 5627B basically provides that where shares are issued by a closely held company at a premium which exceeds the fair market value determined, the excess of such FMV over the consideration paid into the company for the acquisition of shares will be liable to tax in the hands of the shareholder. Hitherto, this was applicable only to residents, but now we are told this will apply to non-residents as well. There could be potential impact from a foreign investment perspective, given that valuation requirements will be mandatory from a tax perspective, which may potentially be in conflict with the RBI regulations, which permits one to invest at any value which is higher than the FMV. So this is a bit of a concern, especially for the foreign investor community. Going forward, I think one of the important things which has changed, of course, is the extension of the period of incorporation for eligible startups to start to claim the deductions for 100% profit. So that has been extended. The tax holiday has been extended for another year. There is also a relaxation period which has been given as far as tax losses carry forward is concerned, and that has been increased to 10 years. Another change, of course, is basically in relation to Section 28(4), which seeks to tax benefits or perquisites. It essentially overrules a Supreme Court ruling in Mahindra & Mahindra, which allowed cash perquisites to not be taxed. So now we are told that even cash perquisites which are received will be liable to tax under 28(4). Minor changes to TDS implications and DCS, and particularly I think for me what would stand out is also the additional TCS which has been imposed on individuals, particularly who are making foreign remittances under the LRS scheme, which was currently at 5%. Now it has expanded to a 20%. Resulting in potential higher cash outflow and a cash flow issue for such payments. Moving on, we have also seen certain tweaks being made to the withholding tax credit mechanism. So today, if somebody were to have offered income to tax on an accrual basis and tax were to be withheld in the subsequent financial year on actual payment, then certain taxpayers were being affected by this on account of the fact that credit was not available or against them is already paid. So this, there has been told that the tax officer can be approached to rectify this issue. And certain other minor changes with respect to capital gains tax implications with respect to market linked debentures, currently, which was long-term, now will be characterized as short-term capital gain. And another interesting development is pertaining to electronic gold receipts, which essentially the last budget had initiated the idea of a similar exchange for gold, which will be regulated by the SEBI. So basically, you know, the existing gold, physical gold, can be converted into electronic receipts. And vice versa. And these kind of transactions will not be liable to any capital gains tax. Moving on, there is also certain tweaks being proposed to the gaming industry, which of course the net winnings, we are told that will be defined at a later point in time. However, such winnings will also be liable to tax at 30%, followed by a withholding mechanism also to collect the tax. On the personal tax front, there are no real changes on the old tax regime. People are being encouraged to not follow that regime, which you know, basically allows for deduction based on particular savings schemes, etc. We are now being pushed to follow more of the new regime, which has you know, absolutely no deductions available. However, we are told that the tax slab rates will be reduced from a six. You know, there are six slabs currently that will be reduced to five. Of course, there are certain benefits such as threshold for rebate being increased from 5 lakhs to 7 lakhs and standard deduction of 50 lakhs and a maximum surcharge, which is also important, particularly for the high net worth individuals. The maximum surcharge has been reduced to 25% as against the current 37%. These are the tax changes for personal taxes, primarily under the new tax regime and not under the old regime. And the new tax regime is likely to become, or we are told that it will become the default provision as far as personal taxation goes. Certain tweaks also to gifts made to residents, not ordinary residents, which we are told will now be liable to tax in India. And there is also certain deductions which are being proposed, you know, which are available in case of capital gains. That has been capped at 10 crores today, now going forward. And certain tweaks to the income in case of life insurance policies, which now will be liable to tax in the hands of the insured person. So these are the broad changes from a direct tax perspective. I will now request Shashi to take up the indirect tax aspects.
Thanks. Thank you, Shruti. So since the inception of GST, of course, we've not seen much changes being announced in the budget on, at least on GST. There's always something that the customs is there. So to begin with, I think mostly the changes in GST follow what the GST Council has decided over the last two or three meetings, and these are mostly implementation, just for implementation, and you know, it's that's how we have progressed over the last few years. But there are some key changes in which have been actually a bit unexpected, and we have an illustrious panel with us who will you know, help us dissect these changes. So one of the main thing is on the input tax credit restriction for the purpose of CSR activities, and this will in the coming days we'll see that there will be some burn on this, because there are advance rulings in favor of the SSC on this, and this is a bit of a surprise on the GST front that this change has come. Then there is an outer time limit of 3 years, which has been proposed for the returns, the different returns under GST. Again, we'll have to see how that pans out. With the push that we have for e-commerce, it is a bit surprising that there are new penal consequences. And you know, e-commerce operators are required to be more vigilant to that extent with who are the people who are operating on the e-commerce website. And of course, as the GST Council had decided earlier, there have been changes in the threshold for launching prosecution, and that has gone from 1 crore to 2 crores. But one of the big changes is the change in OIDR. And OIDR has been a contentious entry in the GST books for some time, And I believe now it will get more contentious because as opposed to what was there earlier, even in the service tax regime, this now has essentially automated and involving minimal human intervention has been removed. So that actually, you know, will have some impact on various services which otherwise would not have fallen under OIDR. So that's something that we'll in fact take up in our discussion. The other retrospective exemption, in fact, which has been given, this was there earlier, but this has now been specifically given retrospective effect, is for those activities already given under Para 7 and 8 of Schedule 3, which is supply, which is neither goods nor services. Well, as I said, there aren't many changes in GST that is there, but I'm a bit surprised that few of these topics, you know, which we have discussed, which we have put out in our PPT, they have we find no mention of that in neither the finance minister's speech nor eventually the bill. One of them, of course, is the GST appellate tribunal, and I think now the wait continues, and pretty much the ball is in the court of the GST council. So we'll wait for that. We've been waiting for the development of Enterprise and Services Hub Bill, which is the replacement for SEZ Act, for almost a year now. And again, there was no mention on it. We, in fact, have some questions on why the amnesty scheme was not introduced. We'll be pushing that to our panelists soon. So that's from the GST bit. The customs bit always is, you know, especially after GST came in, it's always been interesting because now, you know, the kind of view that we have that we are to be an export friendly country and move from a service exporting country to a manufacturing country. Not only are we seeing imports of certain items getting expensive, obviously to make it lucrative for domestic manufacturing, but we're also seeing inputs required for manufacturing the final product. That is getting, the customs duty on that is being lowered. And I think that is one of the few things from the custom side, which will definitely be a plus for the industry. And you know, a lot of people have been, you know, looking at the budget for seeing if that will have an impact on the schemes which have been introduced by the government from time to time. So while we didn't see any new scheme being announced, hopefully these changes will augment the existing schemes. Apart from that, there have been some review of exemption notifications. So if you remember last year, the budget had announced that, in fact, the Finance Act had come out with a provision that most conditional exemption notifications will only have a period of 2 years, after which they'll die a natural death unless reviewed and extended by the government. So to some extent that has, you know, that has been, I won't say diluted, but that has been clarified because India has a lot of international obligations, treaty obligations, which are being affected under the Customs Act. So that is something that, that's sort of a clarification so that no notification automatically expires. So yeah, the others are small changes. One very interesting change is the mandatory time limit of 9 months for the settlement commission. Honestly, I would find that a bit surprising because the whole purpose of the settlement commission is gone if you send the person back to the adjudicating authority after 9 months. So we'll see how this pans out generally for the industry as a whole. So with this, there's nothing else major on indirect tax that will be there. But on the other side, you know, the finance minister did announce that there'll be a lot of push towards ease of doing business as has been done in the past. A lot of compliances are being expected to be removed. Before we run out of time, I'd like to stop here so that I can quickly introduce us to our panelists.
Yeah, sure. So I think I'll first introduce our first panelist, Mr. Siddharth Pai. He is the founding partner and CFO and ESG officer at 314 Capital, which is a venture capital firm in Bangalore. He's very active in the policy space. On matters related to security markets, alternative investment funds, taxation, foreign exchange law, and startups. Thank you so much, Siddharth, for accepting our invite. Then Mr. Nandakumar Tirumalai. He's the CFO of Tata Chemicals Limited. He's a qualified chartered accountant and cost accountant with rich experience of almost 30 years. In the past, he has also been part of other Tata Group entities such as Titan, Tata Power, and various other companies like Raymond Limited. Thank you so much, sir, for accepting our invite.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you. So I would like to introduce Mr. O.P. Dadich and welcome him to the panel. Mr. Dadich is a senior advisor with Reliance Industries Limited currently, but prior to that, he's been a member of the Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs and has an illustrious career as a senior IRS officer. And I'm really happy to be connected with him. And thank you, sir, for accepting our invite and joining us on this panel. We also have Ms. Radhika Rao, who's a senior economist with DBS Bank in Singapore. And we are really glad to have you on board today, ma'am. And in fact, for us, it's the first time we have an economist, as you'll know. So hopefully we'll be able to bounce off some questions to you. Thank you so much for joining us for this panel discussion.
Thank you so much for hosting us.
So yeah, I think before we ask any specific questions, we have a general question to the panel, and I'll start off with Mr. Dadich on what, as per you, are your hits and misses for the budget? And what do you think could have been done more, or what do you think is the big hit in this budget?
Thank you, Mr. Matthews. Actually, I would say that it's continued policy. You know, in the past 3-4 years, we've been saying that now there is a focus on manufacture in India. So like they have been slightly increasing the rates of duties on finished goods, consumer goods, and reducing duties of customs on components and raw material, which can be used for manufacture in India. So if you now see, there is a general feeling comes as if, no, there is across the board reduction. It is not there actually. Wherever reduction is there, it is to those parts and components which are used in the manufacture. And most of them are subject to end-use condition. You'll see there are rules, IGCR rules, import of goods under concession rate of duty rules. So they all are subject to these rules. So I think it's a continued policy on custom side. There's nothing I would say is in unexpected on these lines. And I'm sure that if you look at the past 3-4 years, there has been boost in manufacturing, which of course generates employment and also takes our goods outside now. And if you see all around the world, there is a tendency to raise the tariff because now somebody subtle way protectionism coming again because everybody wants to guard his market. So in that policy, I think customs, they've done very well. I don't see any, and in fact, gold duty has been not increased. It has been adjusted only by, calibrating other duties, but I think on gold, because we're seeing so many smuggling cases, so I think slightly it could have been reduced. But of course, looking at the foreign exchange condition and CAD position, I don't think government could have afforded this. On custom side, I don't think there is anything much can be said. But GST, of course, we all should know that GST budget is not, no, it doesn't deal with the GST matters actually. Only those proposals which have been approved by GST Council, and which need to be taken into amendment of the GST Act, only those are taken along with the budget. Rules, of course, they can amend it any time. So therefore, I think all these what we are seeing today, already approved by the GST Council in past meeting or two meetings past. So these have been only enacted in the CGST Act and IGST Act. And these would take place only when the other states also, they amend their respective GST laws. So these are actually things that are done. Already we knew that those would be coming. Two things I would say on GST side, I fully agree that gaming, this is really, I think it's high time that government comes out, the GST Council rather comes out with some solution to this problem. Because Shoko notices in thousands and thousands of crores are being issued and there is no clarity. It's not the question of how much the rate of duty or how much one should pay. Value could be anything, but it should be defined. So I think this is high time. I think already GOM is looking into this matter. We should wait for this. Second point, I always been in favor of compounding offenses. Because after all, if we 2 crore is not a big amount in that sense of it. So yeah. I think compounding should be really encouraged in custom side as well as in the GST side. So like I was looking at the proposal, those cases which are invoices are issued without supply of goods, these are out of even compounding scheme. So this is very strange because I think you will see most of cases fake invoices, they have no supply of goods. So I think they should also be covered in compounding of scheme, and you may because otherwise courts would be flooded with prosecutions once we see the number of cases being booked under the GST law. So that is, I think, required. On custom side, I think it's all right. Sintlax size, of course, as we know that duties have been raised every second, third year. There is a ritual to hike the duties on cigarettes. So it was expected. I think it has been done around 15%. So, and I'm really happy with the focus given on certain niche new areas, like promising areas like lab-grown diamonds. In fact, lab-grown diamonds is a thing which people, they take it as if they're spurious. They are not spurious, actually. Lab-grown diamonds, they look very as good as naturally grown diamonds. And so far, it was very difficult even to distinguish sometimes. No? So government is allowed duty-free import of seed for this, and then also setting up some research center to develop the lab-grown diamonds. It's a time, I think, if we can, our industry can focus on this, we can be leader in lab-grown diamonds. This I really welcome. And other, of course, if you look at the hardware commission also, these all are very good measures, I think. So on the whole, I don't find any fault or anything missing. On, of course, personally or otherwise, so income tax side is even disappointing. Because reduction, marginal reduction doesn't mean anything. If you want good money amount come to market, then you have to give a substantial reduction in income tax, 2% income tax. Then only money can come. So I think it's only very cosmetic or not very significant reduction in income tax slips. And one thing I was wondering, this A44D, I think I'm, if I remember correctly, this presumptive tax, it is not very progressive. If you look at, if you are, your income is 50 lakhs, now it's 75 lakhs, you are covered by this. It crores 670 support by 1 rupee, then you are out of it. So I was just calculating on the back of envelope calculations. If your income is below 75 lakhs, you pay only around 9 lakhs rupees a tax. If it is up to 1 crore, then you end up paying 32 lakhs. So on incremental income of 21 lakhs, you pay almost 20 lakhs as taxes. So I think this is something has to be graded. Presumptive expenditure should be allowed in income tax side. This is all I think I have to say on this. Then I'll take questions whenever they come.
Yeah, definitely. So thank you so much for your views. I'll quickly ask Mr. Tirumalai also for his views on the budget, just broad-based views on what do you think that the budget has in store for you and the others.
Thank you, Sashi. And I think, first of all, I think the budget has been good in terms of the 10 lakh rupees crore for the capital investment here that's going to spur more capital investments and also be a good driver for growth of the economy here. So the increase in the allocation for capital spend is good. Also, in terms of the lot of allocation done for the transition to zero carbon and green energy also is good here. I think that's the right step taken by the government to encourage investments in those these kind of things here. On the income tax front, I think there's whatever the drop in the rates have been always welcome to any taxpayer. So that's one thing good for, I think, across the tax slabs. Some reduction will always help in terms of the lowering of taxes for the salaried community. That is a small savior in terms of this. Also, the corporate tax rates have not been touched. They came down 3-4 years back in terms of a good scheme. The new regime is good and the tax rates are one rate with no other complications. So those rates have not been touched and kept and retained at those levels. That's also good in terms of not changing the corporate tax very often in terms of going forward. In terms of the, apart from that, I think on the duty part, I think OP spoke about the drop in the rates in the duty of gold. I think 12.4 to 10% here. Any drop in the gold duty is always good. It brings down smuggling. And that's one good initiative taken by the government to bring down the rate so that it's all on an even playing game, the entire industry of gold. So it's a very large industry. It's about 4 lakh crore industry. And it's, again, plagued by a lot of smuggling happening across the country. Any drop always helps in terms of making it a even playing ground. Those broadly, I think, are the things. Apart from that, what I saw in your presentation also was removing of so many kinds of, you know, the compliances is made much more easier now, and that is actually making much more easy to do business. So making the rules a bit easier and making compliances more easy is good here. So I think on the whole, it's a good budget, if you ask me. I think it's going to be a multiplier effect in terms of the taking the effect of the capital spend is going to have a better effect in terms of the industry, the whole economy booming. I think it's broadly okay. I would stop at that. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Before before we proceed, I'll quickly, I noticed that Ms. Rao had some issue with her audio video. I hope that's sorted now.
Hi, Shashi. I'm so sorry about that. Yeah, hopefully, fingers crossed, it's holding up because I'm at an external venue. So it's been a big
okay. Okay, no problem. Can we, so your views as an economist quickly on the budget?
Sure. If I recollect correctly, you had mentioned about the hits and misses, so I'll just keep it short. I think fortunately, our overall take, at least from a macroeconomic perspective, would be that there are more hits than misses. So again, talking about starting off with the math, the fiscal math per se, a couple of things that we look for. The first one would be the nominal GDP assumption. You know, end of the day, the entire math rests on how fast the economy grows. And what we've seen in the past 2 years is there has been an actual, extra cushion on that front. So, you know, it helps to absorb increase in spending or any undershoot in revenues. So on that front, it's been, 10.5% is the assumption for fiscal 24. Our own focus is a bit less than that, but I think it's more or less in line with where expectations are as we go into the new year. So that is pretty reasonable from our mind. The other one is cut back in subsidies. And I think there have been potential savings in food and fertilizer subsidies. And I think that's reflecting in the math as well. And the third one being the bigger capex push. And I think that was the one thing that private sector players as well as other observers were looking for. Will that momentum carry? And what we interestingly see is that's certainly the case. In fact, it's at an all-time high. And as a derivative, what you see is that revenue expenditure, which is essentially the sticky part of spending, you know, that's its ratio vis-a-vis capital expenditure is actually falling. To mean that's encouaging. So more and more resources being put towards capex spending. So all of these, to our mind, I haven't gone into the measures. I think the other esteemed guests have been dwelling deeper into the measures, but this would be hits. And I think one of the misses perhaps in terms of the segments that were directed, to our mind, I think the rural, the farm part of the rural sector, perhaps we had anticipated a bit more of a welfare push in that direction. But when I see just allocations and, money put aside for programs like Manrega, that has actually moderated. So in my initial expectations, I thought that would be a priority. But instead, I think the supply side push has been given a lot more of a headroom. So, in a crux, I would think that's where we would begin with. Certainly, the assessment overall would be more to take away positively than not.
Great. In fact, for Siddharth, we do have a specific question. But before we get to our specific question, we want to know your hits and misses of the budget. It would be quite interesting to hear your views.
I think, Shashi, I'll actually end up being the only contrarian here. I think we've had a lot more misses in this particular budget, especially from a startup and an investor perspective. Most of the investors, as you may recall, in the last budget, the Hon’ble Finance Minister actually acknowledged the role that private equity and venture capitalists actually end up playing in terms of nation building. It promises the creation of an expert committee to look at the issues that PE and VC investors have. This was the Damodaran Committee that was chaired by the ex-chair of SEBI, Mr. M. Damodaran. And everyone from the industry actually went and deposed in front of him. I think the report was actually tabled in December of last year. And the early indication we got is a large number of the asks from the industry, from an ease of doing business perspective, from a taxation perspective, from a structure perspective, from just a recognition of the operations of a private equity and venture capital firm, which I think is actually missing in laws as a GST, wherein some of the flows that a fund ends up generating is actually liable to GST, despite it arising from the sale of securities, which is actually exempt from GST itself. So just an acknowledgement, I think there was high hopes from the entire industry that it'll actually end up finding some utterance in the budget. All of us were, I think, were extremely surprised at the fact that the Damodar committee wasn't actually bought up at all. In fact, I think there was a large amount of hoopla around the fact that the capital gains would end up being rejigged. And we actually saw that as a massive miss because I think the industry was actually waiting for something on the chains, especially the disparity between listed and unlisted securities, between non-resident investors, resident investors and the like. We happen to have among the most complicated capital gains regime in the world, for that matter, depending on the security, on the listing, on the time, and a number of issues for that matter ends up changing. I think the changes they make to the MLDs also actually reflect the same particular scope itself. From the startup side, I think we've seen one of the biggest drops. We've seen this is actually massive, which is the angel tax now applying not just to residents, but to non-residents as well. If you look at the largest funding rounds in 2020 and 2021, the largest amount of money is actually coming from foreign investors. In fact, Indian investors in that regard have been extremely small. Now, of course, there are reasons for the same, such as regulatory restrictions on Indian institutional capital actually coming into startups because they have to be profitable. The startups aren't profitable. Can't invest into AIFs and VC funds because of various restrictions, etc. So all these particular issues have prevented rupee capital from coming in. So the moment we start putting taxes on capital receipts, such as share premium actually coming in, it does become counterintuitive. And I think this is one of the fundamental failings that's going to cause a large number of companies to flip or to actually externalize, move their headquarters overseas. And the economic survey actually mentioned that, saying that India needs to adopt policies to reverse flipping, to get our companies domiciled overseas to start coming back. I think the angel tax thing, which I hopefully can speak a little more about a bit later, has actually going to reverse that entire trend. I think on the positive parts, we've seen that GIFT IFSC has gotten a large amount of regulatory clarity. The taxation element on a pass-through basis for funds based over there is actually of huge benefit, because otherwise what would happen is, because of the lack of clarity, these particular funds could be treated as a PFIC entity, a passive foreign income corporation, because they basically end up getting taxed at the highest marginal rate for all the investors who may be based in the US and otherwise itself. I think GIFT, the fact from an ease of doing business perspective, we now actually end up seeing that the IFSC has been delegated authorities under the SEZ Act, which means the process of setting up, managing operations, et cetera, becomes a lot easier. So I think the investors and startups end up having a fairly tough road ahead, especially in the middle of a funding winter. We were hoping for some support, but I don't think we've actually seen that as of now. Hopefully some mitigation ends up coming before the finance bill becomes an act. So fingers crossed in that regard.
So, Siddharth, since you spoke about the angel tax provision which has been introduced in the budget, how do you think it is going to, do you think that it's going to be a dampener on investments entirely into India? How will it affect FDI? What are your thoughts around that?
Shruti, there's complete paralysis right now, I think, amongst the investing community. I'm fairly certain that both yourself and Shashi would have got numerous calls from my clients saying, how do we structure investments to end up coming into India now? How do we actually prevent this? Now, there are issues. Now, this particular provision came in 2012 to prevent the laundering of funds through investment into unlisted companies at fairly high premium. So they would jack up the price, invest into it, siphon off the money, and then sell the shares back at a fairly nominal price. I believe there's a very famous case concerning a politician from 2008, because of which they actually made that change in 2012. Now, this section has been systematically misapplied to startups, where they started taxing capital receipts in their hands right about now. And this was called angel tax because since it applied only to residents at that particular point in time, a large amount of the funding received by startups from Indian residents comes at the early stage through angel checks, etc. Hence, it was actually called angel tax. I think right about now, it's just become a tax on being an unlisted company. So you look at any of the startups that are there today, the largest unicorns, everyone who's actually cost-cutting, laying off jobs and going, when they do hit the market, end up raising capital, it may be a down round. The valuation may fall. Now, the biggest scary question for all of them is, if the valuation falls, can the tax department say that your previous round, you were overvalued? So you didn't exactly do it as per the fair market value. They're going to tax you. And they don't have the cash or the capital to end up paying that particular tax. And for that matter, no investor is going to come in if a tax demand exists, because they know the moment the money comes in, it's actually going to go to clear the tax demand, because the tax authorities do have almost a lien on that particular amount that comes in itself. So there is panic and pandemonium across everyone. One of the jokes that everyone has right now is, look, why don't we actually just list all our companies? It becomes so much easier. List them on the SME exchange or the SGP exchange. That way you get the benefit of a lower tax. You also get the benefit of not having angel tax end up applying. And I think that's a joke that everyone's doing the rounds. I'm fairly certain that a few companies may end up listing just to actually avoid this from happening. So I think this is misapplication. There are numerous changes that have happened to the tax code since 2012 to make sure that we don't need 56 to 7B to exist anymore. And there's a wide push from the industry right now to actually get this through, especially during a funding winter, the way we're seeing now, adding further restrictions of capital for that matter is problematic. And the argument they've proffered saying that, look, it applied only to residents, let's apply to non-residents. Broad basing an unjust act doesn't actually make it fair. It just makes the consequences far wider. So I think it's important for the government to hopefully have a dialogue with the industry and actually reduce this. Otherwise, India is not going to be a land of startups. India will become a land of subsidiaries. We've already seen a majority of our unicorns move overseas. And we've seen PhonePe come back. I think after this, PhonePe may end up actually redomiciling back to Singapore for that matter to end up to prevent this from happening. So it's going to be a tough time for everyone. But I think the industry is galvanizing together to end up actually solving this particular issue, hopefully.
I want to ask you, Mr. Tirumalai, what would you have liked to see from a manufacturing perspective, for a manufacturing company, what kind of changes would you have liked to see in the budget which has come up?
So being in the chemical space, I would like the PLI scheme to be announced for chemical. It's not come, unfortunately. So I think the industry has done really been supporting the country as a whole. And so we need the support of PLI also to be even do better. So we thought that they announced this scheme that did not come. That was the unfortunate part of this budget year for us, people like us in the industry. Although I think broadly, I think it's okay because this 10 lakh crore push for the capex is actually good for the country to spur the growth.
So I have another question for the floor. This, in fact, comes from the finance minister's speech on easing of doing business, reducing the cost of doing business. In fact, the finance minister has tasked the financial sector regulators with some of these streamlining activities. Just want to get a feeler from everyone. Has it actually helped what has been done in the past? In fact, Mr. Tirumalai mentioned that there have been some improvements. But is a comprehensive review of existing regulations actually required? I would believe the answer is yes. But how fast can we do it is a question. I see Mr. Pai smiling. So Siddharth, please go for it.
No, actually, thank you. I think this issue, particularly Shashti, is something that's actually very close to our heart as an AIF. Now, SEBI's been a fantastic regulator. They have the IPAC, they listen to industry, they take in feedback and everything. And the industry, the AF industry in India has actually grown at a CAGR of 122% from 2012 all the way to 2022. Now, what we require right now from the industry's ask is to actually say, look, the industry is actually matured, it's become fairly good, but some of the guardrails and the restrictions that exist in regulation should not actually exist over there. The promise of an alternative investment fund is that it's actually an alternative. These are primarily contracts between the fund manager and the investor to decide what the investment thesis is, what concentration you look like, how the fund ends up operating. Now, we can't have a one-size-fits-all kind of criteria the way you have for mutual funds itself. Now, those mutual fund criteria actually came about purely to protect retail investors. We don't have retail investors in the alternative space. It's a 1 crore threshold. I'm fairly certain that threshold is going to get increased in the near future as well. So when that happens, we actually need to have the primacy of contract end up actually continuing. I think that's actually crucial. And SEBI has actually been a fairly listening regulator. I think given the fact that the public consultation comes about, this would be great. I think for startups, for fintech companies especially, I think we've seen the RBI be extremely heavy-handed over the past year itself. I think June was especially a horrible month for a large number of fintechs, where we saw 3-4 large regulations come in. Loading of credit onto prepaid instruments was removed. The fact that digital banks may not actually come about has also scared the entire industry. We've seen some of the flows of Morris, etc. are getting plugged. Now, the NBFC space that ends up operating there, we need to have rationality and reform coming. We do actually need regulations for fintech companies, wherein the tech component is as important as the fin component itself, and greater latitude needs to also be given to them. I need to have a phased sort of approach to compliance that ends up happening. A small NBFC can't have the same kind of compliance of what a large NBFC does. RBI did make some steps that way, I think, in last year, where they had a phased approach and said the top 10 NBFCs will be regulated the same way as banks. But the smaller ones need to actually have a slightly lesser regulation. So I think fintech innovation has actually outstripped regulation. I'm very happy to see the finance minister acknowledge that and say that the public will have the right to end up consulting on this. And fintech's been one of the promising areas for startups and for investors. With these changes, India can actually become a fintech destination. I think so, fingers crossed on that particular part as well. And hopefully, before the next budget, we end up actually seeing all this come to law and we don't have a Damodaran committee type issue that's been pushed for another year or a year after that itself.
On that note, Ms. Rao, your views, since I'm sure you're looking at India, especially from a fintech angle, what are your views on these regulations that are being looked to be eased out?
Thank you so much. And I think Siddharth has pretty much discussed the sector in great detail. And unfortunately, I'm not a sector-specific person. But I would think that overall, the question on the ease of doing business has been front and center of the government's priorities, at least in the past decade, and much so in the past 5-6 years. So, you know, if you see various rating metrics, India has done well and continues to improve. So focus has been on across the value chain, you know, starting from the perspective point of registration all the way to exiting the business. So of course, these things do take time to iron out, but I overall, you can see that in terms of attracting FDI, in terms of retaining FDI, as well as local and foreign investments when they want to exit, that process is also being identified by way of the IBC. So I think that very much continues. And at the same time, there is this emphasis on fiscal and soft infrastructure. Soft infrastructure, we certainly have much more strengths playing our way. You know, I'm hoping that the angel tax bit gets sorted as well, because we do need that, you know, tech players as well as the technology to basically permeate through not only large corporations, but also all the way to the farm sector, as the finance minister has outlined in the budget as well. Because it with it comes efficiencies, with it comes, you know, cost effectiveness, and with it comes a lot more data availability and the possibility of making better, stronger decisions, more informed decisions. And going to the hard infrastructure part, I think it goes back to the CAPEX bit. You know, I'm not sure if you're going to discuss this in detail later, but when you see the CAPEX outlays, it's important to not only see what's at the headline level, but where is the money going as well. If we remove, you know, fiscal, the pandemic period, even in the past 3-4 years, in fact, right after, if you were to assume fiscal 21 was the most affected, after that, the CAGR with which money going into roads and transport, as well as railways, you see an exponential rise. So I think the intention is right, and it's a focus on across the curve. But certainly it's going to take a bit of time. And I think apart from soft infrastructure, hard infrastructure, value chain is what Mr. Thirumalai mentioned as well, which is the PLI scheme. I think at this point, of course, the usage of the PLI mechanism is much more in certain sectors than the others. And there was also this argument about, you know, whether it should be expanded to more labor intensive industries as well. I think that is going to be ongoing. And I don't think PLI announcements are really restricted to the budget and could come outside of the budget as well, just as the PLI scheme itself was announced outside the budget cycle.
That's true. That's true. Mr. Dadich, your views on this? I mean, I know you spent a large part of your time in the government side, but now, what do you feel from a ease of doing business compliance perspective? Are we looking at better times ahead?
Yes, Mr. Matthews, you see, you look at the period of 10, 15 years now, and we compare where we were and now where we are today. In fact, no doubt there has been a tremendous change, improvement is there, and customs is one of the parameters where you rank, you know, World Bank ranks the country in ease of doing business, trade across the border. So we have been improving from year to year. So there is definitely change now. Customs side, we have faceless assessment now. The import doesn't know where goods are, like where goods are being examined. So, and I think more than 90% in export side and more than 80% on import side, it is automated. Goods are never inspected, examined, it self-assessment. Within a very short period, goods are out. And there are regular studies on dwell time studies, like how much time goods are being there. So on custom side, of course, there is a far, far improvement. One can feel it. You can see the custom houses, you know, where it used to be a throng place. You know, people would crowd the place, but now there's no one see anybody. Even if you call somebody, you would avoid coming. You'll rather send a mail. So there are changes, no doubt. GST is from very beginning, it has been an automated system. Everything is on registration to refund, return filing, payment, everything is online. So hardly you see, you know, of course, when system is there could be glitches. No? So if it hits one, then of course, he'll be making noise about 100%. It's true, but of course, system is, you know, like it ever improving. And refund side, like you see, you know, even refund automated. Export side different also, of course, you know, it comes through a customs automated. The system matches the documents, the fact of payment of GST and the fact of goods having gone out, and automated the money goes to the exporter's account. So very smooth, I think. Of course, we can never be, you know, more than satisfied and complacent that nothing is to done. Things are improving. And no doubt we are on the right track. We always celebrate the improvement in the rank of ease of doing business. So,
great. Thank you, sir. Mr. Tirumalai, you've been in the industry for a while. What are your views on this? I mean, you've actually literally seen compliance has probably vanished in your experience. What do you think?
No, it's much better. I think after the GST has laws come, for example, it's very good in terms of compliances. It's very easy to handle. As Mr. Opie mentioned, it's, I mean, after the last 5-6 years' time, things have improved on the GST part and all our returns are automatic and you can also match all the returns from, you know, input, output. Or so the whole technology pieces, backbones is very extremely strong. E-invoicing is working out well. So I think all aspects of the GST part has gone really well. I mean, as a department, if I ask my team, they're very happy, saying that all automation is outsourced to Government of India. But whatever you want is available on the platform, you know. So you don't have to invest any money in terms of your own IT network to understand what is happening in GST. So therefore, a lot of work has happened. I think it's on the indirect tax part front, things have really moved in terms of customs duty and in GST, and it's very easy to do business. And now also, they, for example, we used to earlier have, let's say, VAT team for each state. Now we have one team sitting in Ahmedabad, for example, who does the entire returns firing across the board automatically. So I'm saying it's very easy. So the team size has come down from state-wise, region-wise to maybe a couple of people sitting in the office here. So that way, the teams have become now much smaller and much more sharper reports coming in. You can take out any reports you want to on the portal. I think overall, I think it's become very easy on the GST and the indirect tax part. On the direct tax part front, also on the faceless company coming in here, I mean, it doesn't matter who is your authority to assess, but you get all the video links happening properly. But there, what can improve is perhaps the whole litigation part where it takes, I think in our case, some 20 years back, cases are still pending. So therefore, can they expedite the litigations part, all the direct tax, income tax cases we have? So is it possible to close it quickly in terms of years? Otherwise, today I've got cases from the 90s still lingering with the departments here. So some movement there to expedite would be useful is what I'm thinking on the direct tax part front here. Overall, I think it's been a great improvement. As a CFO, I've seen in many companies, as mentioned from Raymond or Tata Power or Titan, I'm saying things are going to improve in terms of compliances being made easier.
That's what, in fact, we wanted to know. Shruti, before you go with your next question, I know Siddharth has to leave and there is a question which has come from the audience directly for him. I'll quickly ask you, the question actually says, being expert in the fintech space, do you think the FM should have focused on CKYC registry? And also, what are your views on KYC changes and its impact on the fintech space?
I think that's fantastic. So the FM, so outside of the fiscal measures, which are horrible for startups, the non-fiscal measures actually give a lot of promise for startups and fintech startups in particular. And the fact that the PAN has actually emerged as a compliance for everyone for that matter, there's now an entity DigiLocker. It means that a large amount of friction in the transaction space in terms of onboarding, etc., can actually be done away with. Aadhaar is the only thing that actually enables Jio to issue close to a lakh SIMs a day at its peak at that point in time for people to open these many Jandan accounts and everything. So I think extending a sort of Aadhaar for businesses for that matter, the way the PAN ends up actually operating will actually go a long way in making that easier, especially with the account aggregator framework we have right now. I think the flows for the consent-based flow for financial information as well for identifying information to go through is actually a tremendous step. This government has been a very strong proponent of the role of technology when it comes to ease of doing business through the GST network, as well as everything else. So I think this is a fantastic step forward that they've actually done. And we should actually end up developing among that. One of the things is, I think, unfortunately, there would be a few startups whose business model was to actually make this a lot easier, store documents for people in a secure fashion, consent, etc., who may end up getting disrupted. I think India is unique in the sense that we have digital public goods like UPI, Aadhaar, etc., which could become unicorns by themselves instead of being given free to the entire ecosystem. So what fintech is going to build on top of that is actually going to be far more powerful and actually end up building upon that entire thing itself. I think with that, the national data policy for the national data governance policy for anonymized data, the 5G labs, make AI in India, great proposals. Hopefully that when they do actually come out in letter as well, they actually adhere to the spirit and the optimism that the finance minister espoused at that particular point in time.
Right. So my next question is to Ms. Rao. You know, this is with respect to the changes which are being proposed to the personal tax regime. So we are increasingly seeing that, you know, the government wants people to adopt a tax policy or rather regime which does not offer any deductions for savings made by such individuals, right? So, so does this adversely impact savings in this country? Is it better to not have savings and, you know, provide with, additional income in the hands of, money in the hands of the taxpayers? How do you think this is going to pan out as far as the Indian economy is concerned?
Thanks, Shruti. And I think certainly in some of the discussions we have had with the counterparts in the past couple of days since the budget was announced, that has been really top of mind. You know, what is the idea behind making or avoiding all kind of exemptions and trying to keep a new tax regime? And now, you know, in this recent budget, that new tax regime has basically been made the default mechanism as well. I think a couple of things. You know, it could be that spending rather than saving, you know, is a better way off. And anyway, we are already a consumption driven economy, so that certainly helps. But it could also be that you're, you know, saving just not because of tax consumption and tax exemption, but saving as a priority. But I don't think not saving is something that is built in the structure, because our savings rate, you know, on an aggregate basis has actually been coming down. You know, the past 2-3 years, again, the pandemic drove precautionary savings, and that was world over, not only us, where we saw a burst in savings in the first 2 years. And since then, as the economy has reopened, actually the household sector, particularly savings, have again begun to come down. And this is coming at a time when you've also seen retail credit or personal loans actually pick up. In fact, personal loans are running at a higher pace than even the loan growth by industries. To my mind, I don't think the intention is don't save, just spend. I think it's a kind of a decision to rationalize the entire tax structure. And I think it's an ongoing process as well, because if you see when it was announced, perhaps it was noticed that the take up was not that great, and then gone on to rationalize it some more by lowering the number of slabs and providing a bit of support to the lower end of the bracket by raising the basic exemption limit. So I think that is where the drivers are. I don't really think it is just a move to disincentivize savings, because that certainly doesn't board with the overall intention, again, of the banking sector, as well as the other asset classes which typically households would go for, you know, which includes insurance. And again, insurance sector also, there is a regulation that has come in about the annual premium threshold, on all policies across, and beyond that, it's going to be taxable. Thankfully, it's not retrospective, so I would think any purchases that made beyond April 23 would be subject to this tax. So, I think in spirit, it is still to do with do save, but we want to simplify the personal tax regime.
Got it. Thank you. Mr. Tirumalai, in fact, just before I come to Mr. Tirumalai, Siddharth has indicated that he has to leave. He had informed us before. Thank you so much, Siddharth, for joining us on this panel. We hope you enjoyed being on this panel as much as we had having you over here.
And I hope all your panelists actually got some insights into the angst and the anticipation of the investors in the startup industry in India. I think all of us are still gung-ho. All of us have learned over time not to rely on the budget as the only policy announcement. The government has surprised us in the past in terms of doing policy announcements during the year. So fingers crossed on that entire piece to actually take it up as well. Tax is not the end all and be all of the entire industry for that matter. Otherwise, Cayman and Mauritius would be the most vibrant startup ecosystems in the world. India is still at the top of it, and Indians will always actually come up on top as part of that. Huh? So looking forward to that. Thank you very much, everyone. Have a good day. Bye.
Okay, so Mr. Tirumalai, in fact, there's a question that Shruti had for you. Shruti, I think you're on mute.
Yeah. So, sir, this is with respect to, you know, this practice. You talked about how your litigation related to direct taxes pending since the 90s. In that context, What do you think about, you know, fighting it all the way up to the Supreme Court, and in the next budget you'll see that, you know, the court ruling is overruled, and we have a situation where anything which is favorable to the taxpayer is sort of nullified. What are your views on this kind of action from the government?
In terms of what, Shruti?
In terms of litigation. So yeah. You did mention that, you know, litigation is pending since the 90s.
Yeah.
You know, so, and then you sort of litigate it, and, you know, to the highest court in the land. So you go up to the Supreme Court, and then, you know, you have in the next budget, if say that with a favorable ruling, you'll see that, you know, the next budget, it gets overturned. You know, when in this case, in this year also, you have, say, for example, the Mahindra ruling being overruled. So, you know, what is this kind of tendency of the government? So, I mean, what are your thoughts around this?
I don't know. I'm just saying that the angst which I have, or other finance guys would have, in terms of, you know, always look at the pending list, is also over the last 20 years. For old company like us, it's always pending for 20 years plus. On some matters here and there, for example, some small case in some courts, or could be, you know, various forums. So I don't know what should be done. Ultimately, I think, you know, there should be some way out in terms of how the department works quicker, or is there a way to settle the litigation through some kind of a scheme? I don't know what should be done. But is there a way to bring it down to this very, very few years, so that we focus on the work? Otherwise, going back to 20 years back record, you don't even have the employees for the background. So we have to go back to the record. I was saying it's quite difficult, and it's very time consuming and cost consuming also. So I don't know, but is there any some ways we can be done to improve the situation in terms of bringing down the number of years it takes to conclude a particular case?
Right. And, you know, you would see that, you know, typically this is also being overruled, right? I mean, in the sense that the budget will, you know, also sort of overrule court judgments, which is happening almost on an annual basis. Any thoughts on that?
I mean, I have no view on that. Thank you.
So I quickly come to Mr. Dadich. So the big GST change in terms of, you know, the amending the definition of OIDR, why was it done? I mean, it beats me why a provision which was there for so long, and removing such an essential part of it, why do you think this was done? And are we actually going to see some litigation on this? Because this would, don't you think someone like, I would say the online coaching industry will get directly affected by this if you remove minimal human intervention?
Mr. Matthews, I don't think so, because these changes, there are two changes have been made in definition of recipient and the OIDR service itself. So these are changes, I think, just to remove the doubt only. In fact, there such a large definition was not required. The same thing which the definition wanted to convey can be conveyed in a very smaller, sanctioned manner. So I think that is what they have done. Like earlier also, it was basically unregistered person who was, you know, and not engaged in trade, commerce, etc., was defined as recipient. Now, in this case also, they have made it like, you know, even government agencies, bodies, what is government body, what is authority, they all were part of the definition. I think it has been simplified and doesn't take away or subtract or detract from what intention was earlier. So I don't think this part would lead to any litigation. Second part, OIDR definition itself, I think, again, I would say it was unnecessary. You know, if you read it, two things, you know, online information and this, you know, whose delivery is mediated by IP technology and over the internet. So I think this is essentially, this is what OIDR meant. And even if you like, you know, just to make it more clear and to stress that without any human intervention, I think this was added. So I think the council board, because it's a council decision, not government's decision, GST council decided, and not now, it was already added, known to us that it would be coming. So they thought it's made it better. It, in fact, rather than, you know, opening floodgates for litigation, I think to close them, it was intended, it has been done. So I don't see any like coaching. You see all these online coaching institutes, I think they all are, I think, OIDR services if they are providing from outside. No, we should also be clear that OIDR is not having separate classification as such. It's, you know, you know, anything, e-books or music or class or whatever you call it. So it is, it would be taken to respective heading only. You know, it's not like that there is a separate, you know, OIDR classification. Just because make it taxable from received from a non-taxable, that is overseas technology, it has been done. I'll give one example. Like books are otherwise exempt. But ebooks have been like, no, ebooks, it's a basically OIDR service. You download an ebook like on Kindle, you do it. So it is 5% GST is applicable on this, because it's separately classified So I don't think it is a something we should worry about it. I think it's only to clarify, would not lead to any litigation in this respect. No, I want to take it further. You know, Customs Act doesn't deal with services. You know, it's only basically goods, duties and goods only. You know. Now, the ratio of services in transborder or even in domestic trade also, it is increasing. Now we are almost one day surpass even the value of services export than the goods export or import, you never know. So idea was to tax, why should this import of services go untaxed? Goods we are taxing. Suppose you buy a book from, you know, import a book, then even an individual has to pay tax on this. You know, whatever custom duty is there. If you download it, then it was, there's no tax. So I think considering that in view, I think this was imposed. And there is a broader issue. You know, WTO has also been grappling with this actually. There is a, you know, if you look right from first ministerial, they thought that we should also tax ET. They call it, you know, this electronic transmissions. You know, they went, I think the same, not much different than YDR. Any transmissions electrically done should be taxed. But since it's such a difficult, you know, challenging thing to even define, to deal with, to value, and no, because there are so many people, even individual persons, and so I think for that they've been postponing to deal with and, you know, take a firm view on this. WTM last 12th ministerial also, they postponed that, you know, maybe for 2 years, then they'll look into it. So it's a combined issue, I think. Till, and the problem lies because of difference, you know, there's a very thin line between goods and services. It is getting thinner and thinner. Yeah. Like I was just imagining, no, you import some goods, you pay custom duty, but raw material is with you and you get on electronic form from abroad, three printing directions. There is three printer here and goods are manufactured here. So what is this? They say you are imported goods or you are imported services. So I think to cover all these things that have been done. So IDR, I think it's a, these amendments are not very, I think not going to increase litigation. But biggest challenge in OIDR is there because it's very difficult to administer. Now it requires that if anybody is registered here, he'll pay a reverse charge because, you know, he'll pay this GST and then he is a revenue neutral to him because he'll take ITC of that. But somebody, you and me, any person, unregistered person who downloads it, then it's a foreign service provider, the OIDR service provider, who is liable to pay GST. But it is very difficult to administer it. How do we ensure it? There's simplified.
Well, I think to that extent, maybe, you know, monitoring the remittances. In fact, I have.
Well, actually, I think government has been thinking of it also, but again, very difficult. I use my debit card for buying or credit card. So either it's a, I think government is definitely should be aware about it. They have to plug it and ultimately, and it's a huge untapped revenue source, I tell you. Because anyone who is like, no, not registered, who's not a business entity, they are day in, day out, they are importing so many things, especially music and now. And Netflix and what we are downstreaming everything. So they are all, most of them are going untaxed. So I hope that something would be done because tax should be levied on these things because you can't, when goods are taxed, why not services?
Yeah.
That's what I have to say. Thank you so much.
I think there's a question for Ms. Rao. So the question is, there's a deficit of about 35,000 crore in the budget due to the changes in the tax slabs and other incentives that are done, and that is being funded by debt. In the current scenario of a slowdown of the global economy, which is that is expected to widen the fiscal deficit, what would be your views regarding the long-term impact of this?
So, thank you so much to the attendee who has posed this question. So I think at the very beginning, like we just spoke in the last question, the logic, I think the justification to rationalize was taken on the basis of the take-up rate for the old tax regime and then thereafter. So what I think the intention was rationalize and also provide some relief at the bottom part of the tax structure. And what has come out of it is certainly there's going to be revenue foregone. And I think the indicative is at about 350 billion. So, but if you look at 350 from the a larger fiscal deficit or the fiscal math is actually quite small, is at about 0.1% of GDP. So it is not to say that, you know, just to fund that, basically debt has gone up. I think there are quite a few other elements where expenditure has going to go up, and particularly in the capex space. And I think that's the biggest expenditure in terms of size, which is anticipated. While on the other hand, revenue expenditure, which is basically, you know, sticky expenditure, things like salaries and pensions and subsidies and interest payments, all of that come under it. And there, only a 1% increase is actually programmed or into the budget. Usually, it's a bit higher than that. So basically, it's just a 1% increase that's been taken into account. So yeah, just to give a context, it's not like the revenue, the changes in the tax regime or the framework is actually a huge dent in the fisc. There are many more items that is going to cost much more. And at the same time, I think it's been balanced is that the government anticipates, and I think we discussed that in the earlier, saving on subsidies. So savings on food subsidies essentially came from, not they want to provide less support, but I think how it has been done is that the pre-pandemic, which is supposed to be a temporary support during the pandemic, the food grain program was announced. It was extended a few times, and finally, you know, as most other fiscal programs which were pandemic related are being wound down, so was this program, which was quite a cost in terms of canning fiscal costs as well. So instead of that, the existing PDS has been made free for a period of time. So that's on the food subsidies. And on the fertilizers, you already know the global prices have come down, and that is expected to bring some relief to the government as well. So whatever has been saved on the subsidies front has been used to offset capex, and I think that's how the balance is. And besides that, even all the revenue heads are expected to do well. You talk about direct taxes. When you see the rupee in rupee terms, in nominal terms, you can see all the major heads of taxation, particularly direct tax, indirect taxes, and as well as non-tax revenues. Those are all expected to do a bit better. And if you, the final point being, I'm not sure if I spoke about this earlier, but tax buoyancy. So tax buoyancy is basically how much does growth do well, and then do revenues also do accordingly. And that assumption is a bit on the reasonable side as well. So yeah, to answer the question, I would think the fisc implication because of the income tax change is not that big. I think the other side of the argument is that enough of a stimulus or a consumption push? Some would argue that it's too small, and you could only perhaps push for higher demand for some of the low value discretionary items, things like footwear or things like apparels, but it might not be a big enough consumption boost to boost growth overall. But on the fist particularly, the burden is not that big.
Just to follow from that, Mr. Tirumalai, do you think more could have been done for the manufacturing industry, since you're from the manufacturing industry? From a rate perspective, Ms. Rao spoke about how tax has been, there's enough tax buoyancy, but do you think anything more could have been done, especially in your industry?
So I think in our industry, look at we make soda ash, bicarbonate, all that. For example, it's got a 18% duty rate over there. And therefore that's okay. But on the crop sciences part, we sell crop care protections at 18% duty. That could have been lower because that's meant for the farmers. So 18% duty on a crop protection is pretty high. And that could have been, I think, lowered in terms of a rate to help that industry. So correct, that's got a more fragmented industry. 18% is quite a high rate to pay. So that could have been done, but that's one of the inputs I have.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Dadic, I read an article of yours on the tax on gaming issue. And I know the ball is in the GST Council's court, the GOM is waiting and all. And in fact, you had mentioned it, that don't you think that the finance minister could still have clarified, or at least there could have been something issued by the board itself?
You see, Mr. Matthews, Finance Minister, I don't think without consent of GST Council, of course, she herself is a chairperson of the body, but I don't think she would have done it. they could have simply said that GOM is sitting, so we'll request GOM to expedite the report. And CBIC, CBIC only, GST Council is a supreme body, constitutionally constituted body. So without
nothing that could have happened anyway.
But I would say discuss this in slightly more detail. But gaming industry, it's high time that now they come out with a solution, because now people are really, it's an indirect taxation. Suppose you are flooded with a demand. After 2 years, then it is difficult to recover. You can't recover this, this GST from the users, from the service recipients. So sooner it comes, the better it is. And it's actually, I think the entire issue is to be examined thoroughly afresh by maybe a bigger team or bigger GOM. You see, extremable claim, if you call external lottery and everything, the betting and gambling are extremable claim by definition. Except these three other extremable claims are exempt. They are neither service or supply, but these three are taxable. Now, if you look at the service accounting code, they are termed as services. GST Act says it is external claim is goods. So even law is contradictory. Somewhere it says it's a goods, somewhere it says a service. Now, under GST Act, it is a goods, external claim. And under sale of goods, it is service, it's not goods. So I think, of course, law can always, Supreme Court judgment also in a very famous judgment, it said ki, the law can define it the way it likes. It can term it as service or goods, that's not the issue. But I think it's high time that it comes, solution is given. And betting, I don't know whether the online skill game should be covered with betting on, it's also not clear. No, dictionaries would not help in this. No, government has to define it clearly. The all boundaries of this activity has to be defined, because it's a very promising area. Already so many investors, and I think there's already a special committee of, PMO, there's a committee to promote this industry, the service industry of online gaming. So I think, I'm sure that, of course, government is much aware of it, and then there will come out a solution. But my personal view is that when your whole turnover is 300 crore rupees, you can't be, given it's shock and notice for 1,000 rupees, because after how would you pay? Nobody can pay. Tax should be equitable, and the ability to pay. You are earning 10%, so maybe you, after 10%, you take 8 rupees, no problem. But you can't take 15. So this, I think, something is to tell about it, and everybody is watching very keenly when this is, solution comes.
Yeah, I think we're also probably waiting for the Karnataka High Court to give that judgment to see some clarity. GOM has been sitting for almost a year now, but we don't have anything on that
front. High Court, even ultimately, the government, the GST Council has to take a call on this. Even if I say, maybe High Court says that it's not taxable at all, because if you go look at the one, when argue that this activity of online gaming is not even, because it's taxable claim, but only three taxable claims are taxable, others are not. But you believe me, and we all know that whenever intention is to tax an activity, and even courts hold that it is not taxable, then government would come out with a retrospective. So, and it should be, ideally, when it is an intention. Sometimes intention is not conveyed in letter, but intention is in. So I think it should be prepared with the tax on this online gaming, but maybe even 20%, because it's a no doubt luxury game. But it should be only on the, not on the entire, or every time you bet it, like casino. Casino, some people argue that on casino, every time, because you enter a table and then keep on, every round, there's so many rounds, you get money, you lose, and then you put bet. Some people said every time you put a bet, on the gross value tax should be levied. I think it is very difficult to monitor, difficult to collect. So ultimately, how much money you are putting and how much the casino owner is making out of it. So he's providing service basically. But of course, these are views this issue to be clarified by the GST Council and then made into law.
That's true. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Ms. Rao, this question is next to you. What do you think the budget announcements, do they matter to the monetary policy, and where are the financing costs headed? Any thoughts around that?
Sure. I think the budget was closely watched, I think more so than otherwise, because we are heading into next 12 months of, or rather, second half of the year to a year forward. We are heading into state elections, selected states, as well as the general elections thereafter. So there was a more than usual routine, attention paid on the budget. And like Siddharth had managed, had you know, shared earlier, many budget announcements or many policy announcements are now coming outside the budget. But nonetheless, as an intention, I mean, was it going to be populist? Was it not going to be populist? And for the monetary policy, that matters a lot, right? You know, what is it? Where is the focus of the government? And at this point, you know, when we're coming out of the pandemic, and the recovery is taking place, it's very important for, and we have just come out of a period of very high inflation. It is important for monetary policy and fiscal policy to basically move in the same direction, you know, complement each other. And so from that angle, if you see what has the central bank been doing, it's been hiking rates. It has undertaken, I think, a little bit more than 200 basis points of hikes. Heading into this year, I think that is what the Monetary Policy Committee must have been looking at, you know, what comes out of the budget. And what came out was essentially nothing that is inflationary. You know, so that no news is good news is the takeaway for the central bank. Essentially, that there's nothing that would spur inflation. In fact, it is still a very much supply side driven kind of push, which means that further down the line, supply will be better, and that would basically bring down any supply side driven blockages for inflation. In essence, it was a non-event. It wasn't really inflationary. And I think what the central bank then is likely to do is focus back on its own priorities, which is, you know, where it's trying to see if inflation is coming down and it's going to continue coming down. And what the RBI has maintained until now is that inflation has peaked. It's coming off, but not all components are moving in the same direction. What is quite sticky is core, and core is basically a reflection of the underlying demand or a bit of pass-through effect. That's still quite sticky. So net-net, I think what their take is that one more rate hike, and I think they meet next week. So one more rate hike and thereafter pause. But heading into next week, there is already, markets are divided now. Some participants expecting them already to go on hold, and others expecting a hike, and we are in the latter. And thereafter, we think attention will then gradually pivot from inflation to growth. And that's why we think there'll be going to be a prolonged pause. On the financing costs front, what came out of the budget was the size of borrowings. The bond markets actually cheered the budget because the borrowing size was marginally less than expected. But I do think that while that's the case, when we go into the new fiscal year, the supply of bonds will be strong. But on the demand side, I think the conditions are not fully conducive, particularly because banks, who are the major buyer of bonds, they are facing a liquidity crunch themselves, right? They have high credit growth and deposit generation has been much slower. So the appetite to buy bonds would be, you know, less than what it was in the year that we are in. So again, net-net, what does that mean? I think the financing costs certainly have some more room to catch up. You know, banks are still adjusting their MCLRs. The part of the bank's book which is linked to the external benchmarks are auto-correcting. So, you know, that's still filtering through the system. And when it comes to the bond markets, you know, risk-free rates, we think, will head higher. And accordingly, corporate borrowing costs also have some room to edge up. So financing costs, I think it's something that, you know, is still a bit of percolation going on. But on the other hand, it won't really fly because we do think that if there is significant volatility, the central bank will come in by way of open market operations to put a kind of cap. But otherwise, I think for the Monetary Policy Committee 101, I don't think they'll have any negative takeaways from the budget.
So I think that's interesting. I mean, if interest rates are going up next week again, you know, it'll be good for the community that, you know, invests in FDs and things like that. So, yeah.
Okay, so we've in fact been just nudged by the ET team that we are running out of time. We have pretty much taken a lot of questions from the audience, and we've tried to answer it. Well, we did want to ask some more questions, but we'll leave that probably for the next budget, since there were some misses here. But thank you all. Thank you specifically to the panel for joining us here. I really hope, in fact, Shruti and me both hope that the audience enjoyed this discussion. It's on varied topics, but I hope everybody got something out from this. Thank you. Thank you to the panelists for joining us. Thank you once again. Yeah, Shruti.
Yeah, thank you so much for joining us. And, you know, it was a riveting discussion indeed. We hope to see you in other discussions as well, hopefully in the next budget also. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.